I'm Jim Turner, and welcome to dLife TV Online. It's going to be a great show in a new place. We'll be here Sundays at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, with new shows about living your dLife. Every week, we'll be sharing insights, recipes from the dLife kitchen, stories about real people living and achieving with diabetes, and so much more. We're glad you're here. Now on with the show.
Hi, I'm Joy Pape, Certified Diabetes Educator, and I'm here to answer the dLife mail. A viewer asked, will an insulin pump take care of my diabetes? The answer to that is yes and no. There are a lot of misunderstandings about insulin pumps. One is that it will take care of your diabetes, and another is that it is a punishment. It's not a punishment. It can help you. What you need to understand is that an insulin pump is a computerized medical device that delivers insulin a small amount at a time. And so this computer is as good as a programmer, and the programmer needs to know what the programmer is doing. So in having an insulin pump, there are some things that you need to know. You will need to learn how to program your insulin pump, and you will need to check blood sugars more often than you used to before having an insulin pump, and you'll need to change your site every 3 days. The reason you need to check your blood sugar more often than you did before your pump is because you'll be taking a short-acting or rapid-acting insulin through your pump. And if something goes wrong with your pump, which it can because it's a computer, you're at a higher risk for diabetic ketoacidosis. And it also helps you learn how to program your pump. It also puts you at risk for hypoglycemia, but so does taking insulin. The good news is having a pump acts more like your pancreas. You can program it to act like your pancreas. For example, if you know that there are certain times of the day where your blood sugars are high or your blood sugars are low, you can program your pump to manage that. You'll be taking less injections, and it gives you a lot of flexibility and freedom. So, will the pump take care of your diabetes? It can sure help if you work with it. This is Joy Pape, Certified Diabetes Educator, dLifeTV.com.
Hi, I'm Chef Michel Nischan, and welcome to the dLife Kitchen. Today, we're going to do a modern take on an Italian classic, chicken saltimbocca. Now, the classic dish is served with processed pasta. We're going to reduce those carbohydrates by using spaghetti squash. It's delicious, and it brings in a variety of other wonderful natural nutrients. Now, let's get started. Here I have a Ziploc bag, and I've used a scissors to kind of cut the sides away, and that gives me a nice, durable kind of plastic to be able to pound out the chicken breast. Fold the plastic over. I'm going to use the smooth side of a meat mallet so that it doesn't go all the way through the meat when I'm pounding it. There we have just kind of like the perfectly pounded piece of chicken breast. And now I'm going to mix some of my favorite herbs. Here I have, you know, a little bit of fresh basil, chiffonade. We have some fresh sage, a little bit of parsley, a little bit of oregano, sliced chives to bring in a fresh oniony flavor, and here we have just some freshly minced garlic. We're just going to do a quick toss of these, and we're just going to take a little bit of this herb, spread it out on the chicken and the garlic, and here we have some pre-cooked ham. Now we have the ham on top of the chicken, the herbs in between, and we're just going to give it a nice roll just like this. We're going to secure it with just a couple of toothpicks. And now I'm going to season each of them with a little bit of sea salt and pepper. Now here I have a preheated pan. I put in a little bit of grapeseed oil. And now I'm just going to brown both of these chicken rolls on both sides, about you know, 2 to 3 minutes on each side, just until nicely golden brown. Then we're gonna add a little bit of chicken stock and cook it in the oven. And we're gonna cover this and then transfer it to a preheated 350 degree oven and cook it for about 12 to 15 minutes or until just cooked through. Can't wait. Now here we go. I believe these should just be perfectly cooked. Now you take them out of the pan, you remove the toothpicks, and then we're just going to gingerly slice it. And I'm slicing on just a little bit of an angle because it really kind of shows the beauty of the mix between the herbs and the ham. And now to plate, we have the most important part of the base of the dish, spaghetti squash. You just cut it in half, roast it on a cookie tray for about 20 to 30 minutes until it's just soft all the way through. You take the seeds out first, and then when you take it out of the oven, you just take a fork and you flake it, and you get this spaghetti-like inside, hence the name spaghetti squash. So we're gonna take this wonderful spaghetti squash, which we season with just a little bit of salt and pepper, and then we're gonna take our saltimbocca, and then we have just some really wonderful fresh tomato sauce, and then I just kind of do a couple of little splashes of sauce across because you don't want to overcover the chicken. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, we have just a little bit of leftover herbs here, and we're going to just sprinkle that on the top. These are chives. I love them for the oniony flavor. There you have it, our take on chicken saltimbocca. It's delicious, it's low carb, it's really, really good for you. Now, for this recipe and other great tips on how to manage your diabetes, visit us at the website at dlife.com/recipebox. I'm Michel Nischan. Thanks for joining me in the dLife Kitchen.
What do you got?
Mexican food.
Hi. How are you?
My friend, ice cream. Love it. Any flavor, any place, anywhere, anytime.
This I grew up eating. Mm-hmm. It's called galactoburigo.
Mm-hmm. It's delicious.
It looks great.
It's custard. It's got honey in it. It's got phyllo on the bottom and on the top. Mm-hmm.
And so what do you do now? You just eat it out of there?
I don't.
I don't
go there.
Uh-huh. I'm not just tempted. Mm-hmm. I give in to temptation.
Okay, so, excellent.
I mean, what's better than cookie dough?
Exactly.
I'm craving my Reese's peanut butter cups, but if I give it to someone else to eat it, I'm okay with that. I'm fine. That'll help me.
I don't think mine is so much the actual watching someone else have it that satisfies me, but it's getting it out of my, getting it away from me. Mm-hmm.
If I'm out to dinner with my wife, I can satisfy certain cravings by having a little bit of what she's eating, you know, mm-hmm. which she doesn't really like, but I'll do it, you know, because she's tired of the fork coming over to her plate all the time. You know?
I occasionally binge, and I feel guilty about it.
Some days I'm able to shut the door and walk away, and some days I'll open up the lid and, you know, take a few spoonfuls and hopefully only stop at a few.
When I do think of binging, I'll start, and then whatever it is, if it's yogurt or ice cream or anything, I throw the rest away.
And if I do take a bite, then what I usually do is take the rest of it, and I have to go throw it away because I want to eat the whole pack.
So you start learning that the occasional binge isn't so bad as long as it's not a daily, everyday binge.
I have a question about alcohol.
It's the only version of grape that I can have. Raisins, no more grapes, but wine.
You crave alcohol?
I have wine frequently. Yeah, I would say I crave it.
I'm like anyone who craves a cocktail early evening, you know, and I will have a bourbon. I too like bourbon.
Like, I would think more about having these cookies than I would about, you know, going to a bar and having a vodka and soda.
And diabetes is like a daily, hourly thing with everybody, and I don't think people really understand what that is.
It doesn't go away.
One of the things you told us you wanted to learn more about is prediabetes, what it means and why it could be potentially important to you or your loved ones. And we have an expert. Certified diabetes educator Joy Pape is with us to address some of your concerns, and I'm thrilled because I know I'm going to learn a lot talking to you.
I'm looking forward to it too, Benno.
Joy, just to start,
Tell us a little bit about why this is so important to you and why you've dedicated so much of your professional life to helping people understand prediabetes.
I have prediabetes myself, which surprises a lot of people, because people think to have prediabetes, you need to be fat.
You ain't fat.
No, I ain't fat, and I wasn't fat when I was diagnosed with prediabetes. In fact, at that time, there was no such thing as prediabetes. But years ago, I was heavy. I was 50 pounds heavier than I am now, and I've kept it off for about 25 years. So when my numbers started rising, I knew it was in the family. I shouldn't have been that surprised, but because my weight was down, I was surprised. And so it's about me, my family, my patients, the world. Right now, the United States, there's 79 million people who have prediabetes. And it's predicted worldwide in 2030, there'll be 240 million people with prediabetes.
So for someone like myself who has type 1, like the tendency, it's almost like there's this sort of weird stigma or thought process that prediabetes isn't real or that it's not important or that it can't lead to something. But prediabetes, tell us about it. I mean, it is serious, right? I mean, it can lead to...
Type 2 diabetes.
Yeah.
I think what you're saying is some people with type 1 diabetes think type 2 is nothing. But type 2 is something.
Right.
The good news about learning more about prediabetes is that this is a time when a person's diagnosed with prediabetes, their blood sugars are higher than normal, but not quite in the diabetes range. So we've learned that you can prevent or delay getting type 2 diabetes by some lifestyle changes. Really, for most people, by losing just 5 to 10% of their weight can decrease the risk by close to 60%. But then on the other hand, not everybody has to lose weight. Look at me.
So it's not all behavioral and it's not all based on your diet. I mean, you can just have there's a genetic component to it, right?
Exactly. So what we do for the most part teach again is lifestyle, meaning eating healthier and moving more. So in my case, when I found out that my numbers were rising, I was eating pretty healthy. You know, everybody's got their thing. Some people do okay with eating and don't exercise, or they're not active enough, or somebody is really enjoys exercise, but like I'm gonna run and do more, but give me that donut at the end. And so for me, the eating wasn't a problem anymore, but I knew I had to be more active. And what was I gonna do? I wasn't one that was gonna go to the gym. Wasn't gonna go to the gym and an hour a day, or it just wasn't for me. What I did realize I would do is I would take a walk, or I'd start to be more active. So I slapped on a pedometer, and I've been wearing this about 10 years now.
And why do you like to know, like, why is it important for you to know what you're doing instead of just doing it and saying, oh, well, I walked 30 blocks today, or I walked 2 miles? Like, why do you like to have that?
Well, most people overestimate.
Yeah.
The amount of activity
like
they do.
Right.
Right. Yeah. And like most people underestimate what they eat. So on the side of activity, it tells me, it's kind of like my clock. I have got a certain amount of number of steps I want to get every day. And I will look at that and it will tell me, it tells me that I need to do this much. Or I'm doing pretty good. I can slow down a little bit, but I have a target to hit every day.
And that helps you do it?
Totally motivates me. Yeah, I look at it, it's raining outside, and I think, haven't gotten out, haven't moved around. So even if I'm watching a TV program, if I'm on the phone, I walk in place, I've watched many a movie, news show, TV, stepping up and down, dancing around the house with my pedometer.
Why would you want to know if you have prediabetes?
Because you can change the course of where you're going and you don't know it because there are no symptoms. So I would suggest if you're less than 45, you're overweight, you've got somebody that's got diabetes in your family, or heart disease, or you go through the list, just check with your healthcare provider to have the blood test. Very simple. Or sometimes there are community screenings. That's how I found out about mine. I was at a community screening, had my A1C tested, and it was over 6. I was shocked. So then I went to my physician, and we did blood tests through the lab, and it came back the same. And I knew I needed to make changes.
And again, why would you want to know that stuff?
Because I could bring the numbers down and decrease my chance to get type 2 diabetes. Bottom line is, I feel like it's going to let me live longer and healthier.
Oh, so that's interesting. So it wasn't it's not a death sentence, and you're not being condemned to some horrible life. It's actually empowering to know this stuff, right?
Very.
What do you want to leave me with?
I want to leave you with, it's doable. There are a lot of people out there who have prediabetes. They may know it, they may not know it, but they can do something about it.
So information from an expert all about prediabetes, perfect.
That's the show for today. Thanks for tuning in. I know I learned a lot, and I want to know what you think. So be sure to share your thoughts in the comments below, and I'll see you here next Sunday, 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, for another exciting episode of dLife TV Online. Thank you.